So as I say, today we're going to discuss the common presentations of paediatric orthopaedics and how you manage them. This is relevant to you if you work in the A&E department, if you are interested in orthopaedics, as hopefully most of you are, and if you're interested in general practice or many other specialties as well, paediatrics itself, you're going to see a lot of limping children and you've got to have an approach to how you're going to deal with them. As always, just as a bit of housekeeping, we prefer if you don't record anything. All of it, as Andre said, will be uploaded to YouTube anyway, nicely edited, so you can watch it there. And again, as always, any questions, pop them in the chat and we will get back to you basically a little bit afterwards after we've so we're not interrupting our presentation. Okay, so we're going to start by talking about the limping child. 1.4 and 1,000 children will present to the A&E department with a limp before they're 14, which I included because I thought it was actually quite a high number. This can be a painless limp or a painful limp. However, it's more often in boys than girls, and there are lots and lots of things that can cause it. And the reason why it's important to have an approach to the limping child is because there's lots of benign causes that you don't need to worry about, but there are some that are pretty serious and require urgent or emergent surgery. So we're going to go through how to assess a limping child, and then we're going to discuss some of the common causes. We're not going to go in depth into all of them because that could be a whole specialty in itself, but we're just going to give you a brief overview of how to approach the limping child. So this is an area where history taking is really important. A lot of the time, particularly in orthopaedics, you can look at an x-ray or hear a brief story of how the patient sustained an injury and think, okay, so we'll manage them in this way or this way. With a limping child, the history is really key. And that's why I've included this sort of Sherlock Holmes type guy, because it's where you've got to be a slightly more of your classical doctor and really find out what's been going on, how long it's been going on. It's important to think about the age of the child, as different ages of children present with limps for different reasons. And we'll break down some of the common causes of limps later on and categorize them by age. It's important to know how long they've been limping for, whether they noticed it after a trauma or whether their mum just noticed that they were suddenly dragging their leg or kind of pointing towards the hip and indicating that it's painful. The nature of their pain, of course, you take a pain history using Socrates, as I'm sure you've all been taught in your own practice. For those who don't know Socrates, it's just a way to think about assessing a patient's pain. It stands for site, onset, character, radiation, associated features, time course, exacerbating factors, and severity. I'm impressed that I remember them all there. But
Well done.
You've got to think about when assessing a patient in pain, and they're particularly important in assessing a child with a limp, whether that's painful or non-painful limp. It's always important to ask whether a child has had any recent infections. This can predispose you to a transient synovitis, which we'll discuss briefly later on, and also might point towards a septic arthritis, which will be more of an emergency presentation. So a really important question to ask. Ask about trauma and always assess in assessing a child for anything, not just a limp, whether there's any possibility of non-accidental injury, whether the story the child giving you is congruent with what you see, whether there are any other injuries that you're a bit suspicious about, and how the child is interacting with their mother, whether you think that is appropriate or their father or whoever came with them to hospital, and whether there's any suspicion that you have. And if you have any suspicion, then you need to involve your local safeguarding teams and go down that route. But we're not going to talk too much about non-accidental injury today. Always ask about fever, night sweats, weight loss, symptoms essentially of a potential malignancy, as that could present with a limp, or that would be a rare presentation of a rare type of cancer in a child, to be honest. As I've said, always consider non-accidental injury. And always, as with any patient, take your past medical history. With children, it's important to always ask about their immunization status and just making sure that there's no kind of underlying problems that you've been missing that the mum's just forgotten to tell you about because they're worried their kid's been limping for a while. That essentially covers the bulk of the history, But especially age of child is, I think, one of the key factors in assessing a limping child. So moving on to the examination. First of all, you would assess the patient's gait as you normally would in any examination. And the most common gait is an antalgic gait, which is one of pain. However, if there is any neuromuscular damage, the child may have a Trendelenburg gait or a circumduction gait, which means essentially their leg is just swinging and they're not really moving it themselves at all. It's just a fancy word for swinging, but it sounds good in an exam if you say circumduction gait rather than swinging their leg. If the child is young and you're suspecting a pathology in the hip, you can do Barlow or Ortolani's test, which we'll go on to discuss in a bit more detail later on. But they're essentially tests to see if the hip is dislocatable and whether it can be relocated. So there we go. As always, look at the patient. Do they look well? Do they look unwell? Children are not the best at hiding if they're very unwell. If they are in severe pain, you will probably know about it. They will seem grisly. They might be crying. They won't be very happy if you're moving their leg around. Also look at the patient's body type. Are they very, very underweight and malnutritioned, which may lead you to suspect a malignancy or perhaps issues of abuse? Or are they obese, which might lead you to think about things like slipped upper femoral epiphysis? Are they letting you examine them? Do they have any other injuries? What position does the hip lie in? So there is a classic presentation that is asked about in exams and things, which is called the Faber position, which stands for flexed, abducted, and externally rotated. It's a sign of septic arthritis in children. And it looks essentially like this. So you can see he's got his hip flexed, abducted, externally rotated there. And that is something that will make you worry if you're seeing this child and examining them. As you always should in a hip exam, but it's sometimes not that commonly done, you should, in children, always assess the leg length. Do they have a leg length discrepancy? So to do this, you would measure the leg length formally, and that's the true leg length, which is from your acis to the medial malleolus. The other way of doing this, which gives you a more immediate sort of, are the legs equal or not, is what's called a Galeazzi sign. So you get the child to lie on the bed, you flex their knees up. Sorry, that's just, again, the leg length as you would measure it. And this is a Galeazzi sign. So you can see here, you've got the child's legs flexed and you can see there's an obvious difference between the two legs, which makes you think, is there a dysplastic hip? Why has this child got one leg shorter than the other? As always, look, feel, move in orthopaedic examinations. And you want to do active and passive movements. This is sometimes a bit more difficult in children, and you might have to make it into more of a game to get them to do the movements you want them to do. And if they're really in pain, they're probably not going to let you do very much to them. And of course, it's just about being professional and not doing anything unethical, not grabbing a child and rummaging the hip around if they don't want you to, the mum doesn't want you to. As always, get permission to examine the patient. Act appropriately, but do try and perform all active and passive movements of the hip. Particularly sensitive is internal and external rotation in that. See if the child's happy to walk around and to move. If they are, that's probably a good sign. If they're not, you may need to have a bit more of a think, and that will sort of make you a little bit more concerned. You can do a Trendelenburg test, which is, as I'm sure somebody has already discussed in these lectures, it's where you get the patient to stand on one leg and you're looking for a drop in the tilt of the pelvis. This again is more difficult to do in children as they're not, if they're in pain, if they're having problems with their legs, they're probably not going to want to stand on one leg while you're assessing for a subtle tilt of the pelvis. But if you can, it's a good thing to do. And always, as I mentioned earlier, assess the congruency of their relationship with their parents. Does this seem like a normal, happy family? Or does it seem like there's something just not quite right? And it's always better to escalate these concerns if you have them, as you don't want to miss potential child abuse. So these are some of the common causes of limping children. Children of any age can have trauma, fractures, get septic arthritis, have tumours or have sickle cell disease. However, it's your more specific causes that you're thinking okay, this child is this age, so we're thinking about this. In toddlers, you're thinking about things like developmental dysplasia of the hip, which we'll go on to discuss later. In toddlers and children up to 10, normally between 2 and 10, you can get a transient synovitis, which is the most common cause of a limp in child. That is where you have a viral infection, which for some reason, we don't know why, causes inflammation around the hip. This creates pain, swelling. Child might not be able to wait there, but fortunately, this isn't like a septic arthritis. This is managed conservatively with painkillers, limited weight bearing, and tends to get better on its own. This is a useful thing to learn, especially for exams, for your medical school exams, as well as MRCS exams and that sort of thing, because they tend to, in my experience, ask questions where you have a two-year-old child presenting with a problem with their hip, and it will be developmental dysplasia. They will have a four-year-old, and it will be Perthes disease. And they'll have an adolescent overweight child, and it will be a slipped tobifemoral epiphysis. So it's useful to learn from that point of view, but also the reason they do that is because it's important to think, this child is this age, this is a possibility. So we're going to discuss some of them in a little bit more depth now. Firstly, developmental dysplasia of the hip, or DDH. So this is actually an umbrella term for three disorders of the hip: dysplasia, subluxation or dislocation of the hip. And this is something that is congenital normally, or is brought on through birth, which is why I've got this picture of a breech presentation here. And the risk factors are, as you can see here, breech position being the main one, but typically it's more common in girls. If there's a family history of DDH, then that's going to point in the same direction, and oligohydramnios as well. So that's something you always need to think about, and it's why when babies are born within, I think, the first 6 weeks, they'll normally be examined by a paediatrician or a GP to see if they have clicky hips. And that's when your Barlow's and Ortolani's tests come into play. So these are tests used in children below 3 months of age who you suspect might have a problem with their hips. Barlow's test is testing whether the femoral head can be dislocated, and that's just dislocated posteriorly. So you adduct the leg and put pressure on from the knee to essentially see if you can dislocate the hip. If you can dislocate the hip, that is pointing you towards a potential diagnosis of DDH. And then you would perform Ortolani's maneuver, which is then reducing the head back into the socket. And if both of those are positive, then that's very, very strongly suggestive of DDH. If one of them is positive, then you're still worried and you might want to follow the child up. But obviously, if you can't dislocate the hip, you can't then relocate it. So you can't have a positive Ortolani test without a positive Barlow test. So the presentation of a child with DDH, as I've said, is often or most commonly a child's mother or father has noted that they have clicky hips and they think this is a bit weird, there's something going on there. Or it's noted incidentally by their GP on routine examinations at 6 weeks. They would then be sent to have an ultrasound or have further examinations after performing Barlow's and Ortolani's tests. After 3 months, it might be noted that they have a leg length discrepancy or they're unable to fully abduct their hip. But that's kind of up to 1 year before the time they'll be walking, the time they'll be weight bearing. Often it will progress for a while and not be picked up, and you'll get people present as adults or as older children who have loss of their lumbar lordosis. They may have a leg length discrepancy that they've never really looked into, and they have a classic Trendelenburg gait. So this is an arthrogram picture, which is not something you need to know about. It's something I included just as a bit of interest. You've got to think about how you image children, especially very young children, as with x-rays, their bones are likely not to be fully ossified, and they may be very difficult to interpret, as well as the radiation dose that they carry. So a child of that age, they're not the most appropriate or useful imaging tool for developmental dysplasia of the hip. So typically we do ultrasounds up to 4 months, and you can calculate essentially the angles of the hip, the alpha and beta angles, and they correlate to how your management would progress from there. And essentially, your aim is to correct those angles. An arthrogram can be used, as here. This is essentially an X-ray done inside the joint, if that makes sense. MRI is a better form of imaging, and often if a child does have developmental dysplasia, their hip may be reduced in theatre and placed in a spiker cast, which we will discuss in a minute. An MRI is then used to see whether that reduction was successful, because X-rays are not reliable and there's a risk of radiation. So as always, our management options are conservative and operative. The majority of DDH is managed conservatively. So one option is an abduction splint, which is known as a Pelvic harness. It looks a bit weird. It looks like some sort of medieval, sort of, I don't know, ceremonial dress or something. But it's essentially to hold the legs in the position that you can see here so that the hip remains reduced and the child continues to develop with a adequate leg length. The other option is a reduction and a hip spiker cast. So a hip spiker cast is what you can see here. It's essentially a cast that goes all the way from the sort of midpoint of the abdomen over both hips. This is just to keep the pelvis completely still so the child cannot move at all. As you can imagine, it's a bit of a nightmare to manage children who are in these for a long period of time, but they're still pretty much the best thing we have in terms of immobilizing patients with developmental dysplasia of the hip. You then have operative management, which is essentially open reduction. So opening the hip and reducing it, putting a spiker cast on them to keep everything in place, or performing an osteotomy, either of the femur or of the pelvis, which is essentially to, again, correct the angle of the hip so that the child's leg length is going to be congruent and restored. I don't know enough about the details of osteotomy in children with DDH to really tell you about it, but if you want to go and read about that, absolutely feel free. Next, we have Perthes disease, or to give it its full name, leg calve Perthes disease. Everyone seems to always refer to it as Perthes disease. This is essentially a vascular necrosis of the femoral head, and it's idiopathic. We don't really know why it happens. It's mostly 4 to 8 year olds who get this, and it's mostly boys. It's thought that it is due to a coagulation deficit and protein CNS deficiency, but we don't really know why it happens. These children just come in, as I say, much more common in boys than girls, come in with a limp that may be painful or painless, and it's found that they have got a vascular necrosis with femoral head. So their blood supply has been disrupted, but we're not sure why it happens. So this can be going on for a long time, as it takes a long time for a vascular necrosis to develop typically. And will often come in as a painless limp, or somebody who's had pain in their hip that comes and goes, they're not sure what's going on, and they're limping. On examination, they will probably have a very stiff hip and won't be able to internally rotate their hip. And again, they may have a classical Trendelenburg gait, or they may have a circumduction gait, which is the thing we want to talk about. In terms of imaging for these patients, what we would get are AP radiographs as well as frog leg lateral radiographs. And what you'd see on these is some medial widening of the joint and just basically a little bit of irregularity. As you can see on this picture, you can see it just looks abnormal. I know it's not an X-ray, but that's showing you what the femoral head would look like in Perthes disease. MRI, as for any pathology of avascular necrosis, is the most sensitive form of imaging. And if you are suspecting it, you've got a child between the ages of 4 and 8 or 9 who's got an insidious painless limp, you're not sure what's going on, there's something on the X-ray you're not sure of, it's just better to get an MRI and make sure that they haven't got a vascular necrosis. So what we want to do when we're managing Perthes disease is resolve the patient's symptoms, whether that's pain, whether that's a limp, whether that's not wanting to move their hip much, and restore their motion. So get them moving again, basically. As always, there's conservative and operative management. Typically, again, the management is conservative. If the child doesn't improve with activity restrictions, so stopping them running around and physiotherapy, then we'd consider surgery after the age of 8 years old. And again, this is by osteotomy, which is something that if we can avoid, would be best for the patient, and the majority of these cases resolve on their own. Next, we move to slipped upper femoral epiphysis, or SUFI as it's known. So as you can see on this picture here, it does really what it says on the tin. It is a slip of the epiphysis of the upper femur. These, as I said before, are normally adolescents, so early adolescents in the rapid period of their bone growth. And it's typically larger children, so children who may be obese, who normally sustain these. And it's sometimes an acute thing, so suddenly they've noticed a lot of pain, but it's not always that they can pinpoint exactly when it started. They may have just woken up and they have pain in their hip. And again, this is where you'll get your antalgic gait, which is just a painful gait. And again, in terms of our imaging, in children compared to adults, we like to get AP radiographs and frog leg lateral radiographs, which I think I have one on the next slide, so you can see what they look like. Also with the SUFI, it may just be that the child is obese, and that's what happened, but there's a much higher incidence of SUFI in people with underlying endocrine disorders, particularly hyperthyroidism. So that's something you've got to consider, and if there are any other features, at least do some thyroid blood to make sure they've got no underlying pathology. So this is a frog leg lateral radiograph. And it shows a left-sided slipped upper femoral epiphysis. You can see here with the image on the right-hand side, it's explaining the pathology compared to the normal side, what this looks like on an X-ray. It's relatively easy to spot. However, it is easier to see on this sort of image, which is what we call a frog leg lateral. So management of the SUFI is normally operative. So what we do is fix it in situ, because otherwise that's not going to heal or heal in the right position on its own. And you don't want the child to have a non-union, a potential lifelong limb length discrepancy. Let's see, I did have a picture. So you can see here, this is a cannulated screw that has been used to fix a SUFI. It seems, if you compare it to the other side, like the hip shaft angle has been restored well, and that's kind of what we're after doing. If your fixation isn't sufficient, then again, you may have to consider an osteotomy later down the line. Septic arthritis. I'm not sure if you guys have already had a session on septic arthritis, so I'm not going to too heavily focus on it, but this is the emergency presentation of a child with a limp that you need to really worry about. You need to think about other things that it could be. It could be, as I mentioned earlier, transient synovitis, which is actually the most common cause of a limp in children. However, your job really is to make sure the child does not have a septic arthritis. So you want to do, as well as your history and examination as discussed before, you want to do blood tests. You want to make sure the patient is stable. You're particularly looking at the ESR and the CRP in children with septic arthritis. You may want to do a scan to look for an effusion. However, if you are suspecting septic arthritis, it may be that the child needs emergent or at least urgent surgery to wash the hip out. And as always, with any septic patient, you would follow your sepsis 6 and get blood cultures as well to try and identify the bug. As always, with septic arthritis, you try and get a joint aspiration if you can. We like to do this before we start patients on antibiotics, because if you started a patient on antibiotics and then aspirate the joint, it may be that the bugs that are there are not grown because they're being suppressed with the antibiotics you've just given them. In children, it depends on what joint your concern about septic arthritis in. And if you have enough clinical suspicion, then you may proceed straight to a hip washout or whatever joint you're dealing with. So there is a criteria called Cocker's criteria. This is a criteria to judge how likely it is that a child has septic arthritis. And these are the criteria you can see here with the likelihood of septic arthritis at the side. So if they have all four, they have a fever above 38.5, they can't wait there, they've got a high ESR, high white cell count, 99.6% chance of septic arthritis. That will be an indication for urgent surgery and a washout. It gets more difficult when the child only has one of these. However, you really don't want to be missing septic arthritis. So I mentioned briefly earlier that your management, as ever, would be with an A to E approach. If the child is very, very unwell, then you may need to involve the paediatric colleagues and manage as per ATLS guidelines. And with any septic patient, you'd be doing your sepsis 6 as usual. In terms of an operation, would that be irrigation or washout and debridement of the affected joint as soon as possible? You would give IV antibiotics. And normally in children, they have a good prognosis unless they come in very, very young, below 6 months, or this has been waiting at home or not been seen as delayed presentation of septic arthritis. That can progress to systemic sepsis, septic shock, and ultimately death if not treated emergently. You can also later down the line have associated osteomyelitis from a septic arthritis of a joint. So in exams, they will always ask you about common organisms for things, and it's no different for septic arthritis, and they're slightly different in children to adults. So in neonates, you're worried about group B strep infections. From my knowledge of paediatrics, for in virtually all body systems, but particularly in the hip, that's the most common cause in neonates. Over 2 years old, Staph aureus is the most common organism, which is the same as for adults. And in adolescents, Neisseria gonorrhea is the most common. There is also the Hackett group. I'm not going to go through saying them all individually, they're a bit of a mouthful. But these are another group you've got to consider. They're also common in infective endocarditis, and you want to make sure that the patient hasn't got an infection elsewhere that spread to a joint, as well as managing the infection of the joint itself. And with managing paediatric patients, it's normally best to have a multidisciplinary team approach. So have a paediatrician seeing the patient as well as the orthopaedic team. I think that's always how it will work out best for everyone. So this is just another little mnemonic of things to think about in a child presenting with a limp, the most common causes. So stop limping. And as you can see here, septic arthritis, a toddler's fracture, osteomyelitis, Perthes disease, a limb length discrepancy, inflammatory causes such as transient synovitis, malignancy, pyomyositis, ileocerous abscess, neurological cause, and then a potential bowel or genitourinary cause. There's a lot of different causes and we don't really have time to go through each one of them, but hopefully that provides you with at least an overview of the most common ones. And for your own purposes, the most common things asked in exams are septic arthritis, transient synovitis, Perthes disease, developmental dysplasia of the hip. So those are why we focused on these ones, which we feel are most important. Next, we're going to move on to supracondylar fractures. So these are fractures of the humerus above the condyles, as you can see here. And you can see here there is a AP-ish x-ray and a lateral x-ray of a forearm. It shows the entirety of the elbow joint, but doesn't show the distal radial ulnar joint or a significant portion of the humerus. It demonstrates that there is a anteriorly displaced supracondylar fracture. These are common injuries in children, and we see them quite a lot in the A&E department, and it's important to have a framework for managing them, because we do worry about these injuries. And the reason why we worry about these injuries so much is if you look at the anatomy here and consider the anatomy of the elbow, you can see on the left image, you can see the articulations of the joints. You have your ulnar humeral joint and your radiocapitellar joint. These are fractures above that area, which is why they're supracondylar, above the condyles. However, in this region, you can see on the picture on the right, you have your brachial artery and you have your median nerve, or more specifically the anterior interosseous branch of your median nerve, which is the nerve that makes you be able to do that, to the AOK side. And in these injuries, they can be displaced and they can impinge on the blood supply to the forearm, to the hand, as well as the nerve supply. So they're high risk for neurovascular injury. So a child may present, the typical presentation is after trauma, having either fallen on an outstretched hand or fallen directly onto their elbow. I think they used to be called monkey bar fractures because children often fell off monkey bars directly onto the elbow and sustained supracondylar fractures. They'll present with pain, refusal to move the elbow, and you'll see swelling around the elbow typically. However, even if there's no swelling, I would get an x-ray to be on the safe side. Normally you'll see a slightly obvious deformity. They'll have limited active elbow motion, which is flexion, extension, pronation, supination, things you need to be checking. And always, as with any pediatric injury, exclude a possibility of non-accidental injury. So as I said before, yeah, normally a traumatic injury. It would be strange to get one without that. And if their story isn't one of trauma, or what the parents are telling you is not quite adding up with what you're seeing on the x-ray and seeing in the child in front of you, then again, raise your concerns. And these are commonly extension type injuries. So in terms of the examination, this is just a slightly cruder picture of what I was talking about before. With supracondylar fractures, we worry about the brachial artery because it's right in that zone. So it's very important that you do a thorough and complete neurovascular assessment. So as I said before, you want to be testing all the nerves of the hand as you normally would, your radial nerve, your ulnar nerve, your median nerve, but particularly your anterior interosseous nerve, which is the AOK sound like that. You want to palpate the radial artery, and if there is a pulse, excellent. If the pulse seems weak or thready, or there is reduced capillary refill time to the hand, then you may want to consider other things such as getting an ultrasound Doppler. As if the child has a pulseless hand, this moves from being a nasty injury which might require urgent surgery to an emergency. So yeah, as always with the neurovascular assessment of the hand, make sure they can abduct adduct fingers, cross the fingers over, make an okay sign, as I'm sure you've discussed in your session on hands. And yeah, this is the most important thing about managing supracondylar fractures, really. And it's important that you check and check and check again. Yeah, as I said, and if you're worried, get a Doppler scan and consult a vascular team if you do think that there is an arterial injury. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how to interpret the radiographs of supracondylar fractures. As always, you have your PI, PJ and parts, as Andre and Emma have taught you, with an approach to any radiograph, which I think works really well. However, in supracondylar fractures, you're particularly interested in the anterior humeral line, which is the line you can see on this x-ray, which is a lateral x-ray on the right. And what you're interested in is whether the anterior humeral line intersects the head of the radius, basically. And if it's displaced, then that's not good and is an indication for surgery. The other thing you need to look out for in x-rays of supracondylar fractures is what we call a fat pad sign, which is essentially inflammation of the fat pads around the supracondylar region, which can be seen in the form of mild swelling on an x-ray. And this is suggestive of an underlying bony injury. I don't know if you can see my mouse, but this is a fat pad here. And there's a small one.
Yeah, we can see the mouse.
And that is a sign that there's supracondylar fracture. This one, I think you would probably make out that there is a fracture, but some x-rays, a child comes in, you can't see a fracture, but you can see a fat pad. And if that's the case, we tend to treat it as an undisplaced fracture. A problem with interpreting x-rays of children, particularly at the elbow region, is ossification centers. So ossification centers are primary and secondary, and they're basically how bones develop in children. The problems that these create is that depending on the age of the child, you could be looking at part of the elbow and thinking, is that a fractured medial epicondyle, or is that actually just an ossification tender and that's a bit of bone developing? It's probably at the level of this to know, but this is the way in which the elbow ossifies. So capitellum first, radial head, medial epicondyle, trochlea, olecranon, lateral epicondyle. And you can see there the years that they appear on x-rays. And it's just something to bear in mind if you're assessing x-rays of children who've come in with elbow injuries, because you can be tricked. And even very, very experienced people can be unsure about these injuries on x-rays, CT scans, MRI scans. So it can create a bit of difficulty. Supracondylar fractures are classified by the Gartland classification, which is essentially, as you can see in this picture. So it's a three, there's technically four types, but in practice, we really use three types. Type one is a non-displaced fracture. As you can see there, there's a crack in the supracondylar region, but it's not displaced at all. Type two is a displaced fracture. However, what makes it a type two and not a type three is that the posterior hinge, this area here, is still intact. It's not completely all the way across. And a type three fracture is a displaced fracture like this. So this is important because it dictates in a way the way we manage these injuries. So if a fracture is not displaced, it's unlikely that we'll need to do surgery on it, and the child can go in a cast for 4 to 6 weeks and it should heal up nicely. In a type two fracture, with the posterior cortex intact, it is displaced and it would need manipulation under anesthetic, likely in theatre. This could be manipulated and placed into a cast on its own, or it could be held in place with close reduction and percutaneous pinning, or called K-wire fixation. Kirchner wire, it's just a small wire we use to hold the bone in place. Type three is completely displaced and is an indication of surgery. And also, if you see that in an x-ray, it's one of those x-rays where you see it and you go, oh, okay, that's bad. I need to go and do something now. I need to go and make sure this child has a pulse and that they have a good neurology distally. So those are your three types. Try and remember them now, because I'm going to be going through a couple of x-rays in a sec. I'm going to be asking you to pop in the comments what type you think they are. There is also a type four, but this is a type which is determined operatively. It's essentially the same as a type three, but when you take the child to theatre, it's more unstable than a type three injury. So I think now we've got some cases. So would anyone be able to pop in the chat what type of what Gartland classification this supracondylar fracture is?
Yeah, I can just give them a few seconds to type.
Yeah, sure.
So someone said type three.
Yeah, exactly. Well done, Patricia Pepe. You can see that this is significantly displaced. It's not the best x-ray in the world. Sorry, they're from ortho bullets, but they seem to have come out a bit grainy. The posterior hinge is not intact. You can see clear daylight between the proximal and distal humerus. That's a type three. This would need manipulation under anesthesia and likely percutaneous pinning. Good. What type do we think this one is? I find it easier when looking at supracondylar fractures to look at the lateral x-ray. It gives you more an idea of the injury than the AP view, which can be difficult to interpret.
I think everyone's a bit shy today. Mm-hmm. Oh, someone else said one question mark.
Yes, this is a type one. Well done, Sangeeta Lama. So this is a type 1 injury. You can see, you could argue maybe it's a tiny bit displaced, but it's not really displaced at all. There is a tiny hint of a fat pad sign there, and this could be managed conservatively. And I mean, someone's got a really easy question to answer here, but what type do you think this is? There's only one left, so. Both of you, perfect. Yeah, so this is a type two injury. You can see there, this is slightly displaced. If you're drawing your anterior humeral line down here, it would be intersecting with the ulna there. Basically, it shows it's displaced a little bit, but you can see the posterior cortex of the humerus is intact. So the posterior hinge is intact, which means it's a type 2 injury. And this is a patient where you'd put the patient in a cast, take another x-ray, and then you can decide from there whether the patient needs an operation or not. So I've discussed while talking about the Gartland classification, the management of supraglenoid fractures. But as always, when you see these children in the A&E department, take an ATLS approach with A2E management, manage other injuries if they're more urgent first, and ensure that it's a closed, isolated injury. As I've said before, neurovascular assessment is the most important thing. We're worried about that brachial artery. And what we would do in terms of putting a cast on for this patient, you'd want an above elbow back slab cast, and you want that to be around 90 degrees. As you can see, this is, it's no good if you've got the child with their arm down like that, the elbow's not in a stable position. You want the child flexed up. It may be difficult as it's quite painful, but you want the arm to be flexed up as close to 90 degrees as they will allow you to get the arm. And then once you put a cast on, always reassess the neurovascular status of the patient, especially in this type of injury, because it can change, and always re-x-ray to see the position you've immobilized the patient in.
Yeah, let me just say a few things, because people usually miss on how the back slabs should be done. This is a very important thing, because you might even correct a type 2 to the point the consultant, when he sees the x-ray, he says, well, I'm quite happy with the back slab now, we're going to avoid theater. So you might avoid taking a kid to theater just because you did a proper back slab. So yeah, above the elbow, 90 degrees as much as you can, and the child tolerates. Some people say you should supinate the arm, the forearm, so palm facing up, so they can see that the radial head lines nicely. But yeah, and the plaster should go dorsally to all of this and at least stabilize the elbow itself. So importance of the back slab in this type of injuries is like of the utmost importance, but yeah.
Absolutely. And yeah, if you can save a child going to theatre just by putting on a good cast, fantastic. Your boss will be very happy with you. So conservative management, such as Gartland's type 1 injuries, would be just treated in the cast as described there by Andre. And the injuries that we would treat just in a cast for 4 to 6 weeks with fracture clinic follow-up, probably every week or 2 weeks, would be type 1, but also type 2 injuries where the anterior humeral line is intersecting the capitellum and where there's minimal swelling and no comminution medially. So if they have those and the child's in a cast and the x-ray looks good, then you might want to consider managing the patient conservatively. These children heal very well. Operatively, the mainstay of management is a manipulation under anesthesia and K-wire fixation. You can see here, this image A shows a significantly displaced supracondylar fracture. However, on image B and C, this has been fixed nicely using two percutaneous pins or Kirschner wires. This is what most children would get coming to theatre with a supracondylar fracture. However, you still need to be very careful about the vascular status of the patient. You're very close to the brachial artery, and you need to continue monitoring the status of the patency of the hand after the operation, as it's possible that you could puncture the artery with your wire. There could be an intimal tear due to traction in the operation. There's lots of bad things that can happen with these injuries. So if the hand is pulseless but is perfused, it's an indication for urgent but not emergent surgery. If there's a sensory deficit or it's really swollen, again, that's urgent, but it's not an emergency as long as the hand is perfused and there's no occult neurological deficit. Whereas if it's pulseless and the hand is going white, you need to be taking the child to theatre as soon as you can, calling everybody, getting the patient there as soon as you can to get them under an anaesthetic and get it fixed, as you may be potentially saving their limb. So this is one of the presentations in paediatrics that can normally be fine. The majority of these children may not even need an operation, but it can be very, very bad and potentially limb threatening, which is why we want you to have a little bit of a knowledge base about it. And if percutaneous wires, K wires, fail, or you're not able to hold the humerus in place with them, then they may need an ORIF or an open reduction with internal fixation, with or without a vascular repair, if this is an emergency and they've got a pulse to his hand. And that will be done by a vascular surgeon who you need to liaise and contact with. That would be a repair with plates and screws. I think that's the majority of what I was teeing up for you guys today. So the main things that I would like to take away are having an idea of differentials for the limping child and thinking about their age when you are assessing these children. So thinking they're 4 to 8, they could have birthday disease. Below that, consider DDH. Above that, consider SUFIs. That's also very useful for your MCQs. Sepsis arthritis is an emergency and it should be treated as one. And always, again, A to E, sepsis 6, those are the most important things. And neurovascular assessment is very, very important in supracondylar fractures, as well as what Andre said before, putting on a good back slab can save a child an operation. I'd say that is another take-home message. So that's everything from me, but I'm going to hand over now to Rashid, one of our registrars, thanks, who's going to talk to you about some more pediatric presentations. Thank you.
Thank you, Rory. Thank you. I think Rashid's around. I can pin him and we'll stop sharing and allow Mr. Rashid to go on. Hey, Rashid, can you hear me? I think you muted, Rashid. Sorry. You're still muted, yeah.
Hey, can you hear me now?
Yeah. Hi, welcome.
Thanks for inviting me again to give a talk on in the fracture school. Rory has given a very good outlay on exactly, you know, what to look out for in a limping child, in septic arthritis, and also in supracondylar fractures. So as you all will know, these are very important pediatric presentations, and they tend to be the emergencies, the things we look out for, the things our ears perk up for when they come into A&E. And over the next, I know we've been here for almost an hour now, but over the next 15, 20 minutes, I'm just going to run through some pediatric fractures, fractures that we see more in the pediatric population. I mean, the broken bones are broken bones, so adults can break bones and children can break bones. But there's particular special things about a child's bone, which means that they break in a different way, which is what my section is going to focus on. Rory's done a good job to explain to you how to examine the pediatric child. So using a look, feel, move approach, and making sure that you cover a solid history of the child's background, the trauma around particular injury, and then you manage appropriately. So let's go through some slides. It's going to be mainly pictures, unfortunately. Okay, so first things first, always look out for child abuse. So child abuse comes in different forms. I think Ruby mentioned initially non-occidental injury, and that we're not going to delve into too much of this in this talk, but it's a pediatric talk and it's orthopaedic, so we have to talk about NAI. NAI stands for non-occidental injury. There's different types of abuse. You can suffer from neglect. So sometimes parents don't hurt the child physically. They don't go out of the way to injure a child. Sometimes they just lack the support that they need. They might have difficulties in their lifestyles, which means that the child becomes neglected and all they need is support. So it's not always a finger to point or blame. Sometimes your history might save a child's life, might save other children's lives, and also might help a mom or dad become better parents because you just assisted them and given them support. So look out for neglect, look out for physical abuse, sexual abuse, and also psychological abuse. Always involve the pediatric team early if you suspect this happening. And don't just suspect every single child or parent that comes into ED of abuse. Take a good history, take an examination, and you can get a feel of what's going on. If not addressed, it can lead to repeat abuse, and that could eventually lead to a child's death, which you're trying to avoid. And always make sure that you document clearly and document profusely exactly what your history was and what your examination was, and if you have any safeguarding concerns. If it's a busy hospital, no one can help you, you're struggling to get the help you need, then always just admit the patient. It's not a problem to admit a child overnight for observation. And that could also give time, you know, for you to get more history, get a better idea of what's going on, and also safeguard the child for anything in the outside world. So some things that might ring a bell in your mind are, for example, red flags, so inconsistent history. So everyone's saying something different every time you ask them a question. Initially, it's, oh, the child was awake, then it was asleep, then someone came to see them, or they fell over, or no, they can't walk, they're crawling. Just have a consistency throughout your history, look at the documentation, make sure that everything fits and everything makes sense. If a child's been brought to hospital a few days after the incidents occurred, and it's a high trauma injury, you're thinking to yourself, this could not be missed for the last few days. Again, have a sense of potentially there's some neglect or some abuse going on. Look at the child's body, examine the child apart from the actual place that's fractured or injured. Do a quick systemic examination of the child. Look for other injuries they might have suffered as a result of the trauma that they've gone through. So look at the head, look at the neck, look at the body. Look for signs of bruising of different ages, which could show long-term physical abuse. Have a high suspicion for a child who doesn't mobilize. So a child who is normally reclined on the back, generally they don't fall from great heights. So generally they don't hurt themselves. So ask yourself a question, why is this child coming in with a femoral fracture when they don't walk around? Also fractures with twisted injuries. So if you twist a child's femur, it could crack. Again, look for oblique fractures, look for squeezing finger marks on the child's legs. Things like that will give you an idea of what's going on. Sternal scapular rib fractures are very unlikely in kids. They have very pliable bones. So this could indicate that the child is being squeezed or shaken. So again, keep this in mind. And generally, these things will be managed in an MDT. So with your pediatrician, with the orthopedic surgeon, with the A&E staff, and with safeguarding team. So all these questions don't have to be answered by you in particular. Just get help from the multidisciplinary team. So now let's get into the fractures. So like I said, I'm going to focus on what makes a pediatric fracture a bit more special, a bit more different than an adult fracture. There's so many bones in the body, I don't have time to talk about every single fracture that could potentially happen or every single management plan. But to get the general idea, like in an adult, we have kind of two main sections of the bone. We have the diaphysis and the metaphysis. Whereas in children, they have a special part called the growth plate or the physis. And this is generally where the bone or new bone is laid and grows from. So here in this picture on the right-hand side, you can see that this femur of a child shows a diaphysis, which is the long section of a long bone, the metaphysis, and the epiphysis. Now, these are just lay on either side of the physis, which is the growth plate. And this, in the distal femur here, is where a lot of the growth in the femur will occur. And to go pushing the epiphysis more distally, up until the child at the age of 18 to 22, for example, stops growing, and then all these growth plates gradually close and become just simple lines in the adult bone. Now, fractures can occur at growth plates, and we call them physio fractures, and they're classified according to the Salter Harris classification. So to make it easy to remember, you can use Salter as your way of remembering the five types of Salter Harris fractures, which are five types of fractures that occur at the growth plate. And this could be growth plates in any part of the body. So you have growth plates in your wrist, you have growth plates in the distal femur, you have growth plates in the proximal and distal tibia, for example. And you apply a similar rule to everything. So a type one fracture is where you have a separation through the growth plate. So imagine the growth plate has been split from itself. These have a good prognosis, and generally you might not see it on an x-ray. So you can see on this distal tibial physis x-ray here, it might look normal to you, but then the child still presents with pain. And if they do, then just manage it as you'd manage any other fracture and just put them in a below knee back slab to just keep them comfortable at least for a week or two until the pain resolves and the fracture would heal. Generally, as we go from type 1 to type 5 of the Salter Harris classification, the prognosis gets worse. So type 5 has the worst prognosis and type 1 has the best prognosis. So prognosis being the ability for it to have a good outcome. Type 2 is a fracture that starts off again in the growth plate and the physis, but the forces exit in the metaphysis. So it exits up and above the physis. So this is A, so as part of Salter, A is above. Type 3 exits below. Again, starts off in the physis, but the forces exit below, generally into the joint. So these are intra-articular fractures. So as you can see, as we're going from 1, 2, and 3, we're getting more complex injuries. We're going to a more complex type of fracture or a more difficult type of fracture to heal from. Type 4, or you can remember it with a T, as part of Psoter, is a fracture that goes through all three parts of this long bone. So the metaphysis, the physis, and the epiphysis. And again, has a worse prognosis than a type 3 fracture. And lastly, we have a compression fracture at the physis. Again, imagine an axial load, so a child jumping on something or falling into an outstretched hand, and then the growth plate is just crushed. And the growth plate is crushed, and then that leads to the worst prognosis you can have, whereby you have a destruction of the growth plate. And generally, when you have damage of growth plates as a result of any of these injuries, what it means is that part of the growth plate that has been fractured or broken or disrupted has less chance of healing and growing in the future. So you might have growth arrest of the bone, and the bone might grow in a different configuration to how it will grow on the uninjured side. So you might get deformities down the line. You might get shortened limbs or deformed limbs, which would have to be addressed later on by the elective orthopedic pediatrician, for example. Next, we have, I'm just going to go through upper limb and lower limb fractures. I'm going to go through them using x-rays. And remember, you have your mnemonics that were given to you by the fracture school as to exactly how to describe these. But I'll just describe them to you, just highlights the importance of why these might happen in pediatric population. So here we have an AP and lateral, or at least an oblique and lateral x-ray of the wrist in a skeletally immature individual. So this isn't a child. You know it's skeletally immature or it's a child because they have growth plates, they have physis. So these lines going through the proximal and distal parts of each kind of long bone generally indicate a pediatric skeleton or a child skeleton. Here, you can see a fracture at the growth plate. So this is a clear distal radius fracture, but affecting the physis or the distal radius physis. Because of the fact that the fracture exits above, so it's a bit different with the hand sometimes, based on if the hand's facing down or up. But here you can see that it goes away from the joint and exits above. So this is a Psoter Harris type 2 fracture of the distal radius in this child. On the AP view, you can see some mild, about 15 to 20 degrees translation, and also some dorsal angulation on the lateral view. This would need to be managed usually by the orthopedic team, who will take it to theater just to manipulate it into a better position under image guidance. It's difficult to manipulate these kind of fractures in A&E, because if you make a mistake or if you keep on doing it over and over and over again, you'll gradually rob and damage the growth plate. So you want to do it once and do it well. So generally, if you see a Psoter Harris type fracture, just let the orthopedic team know, or put the child in a back slab of some sort, let the orthopedic team know, and then they can manage it for you or tell you exactly what to do. Don't necessarily always try to manipulate these fractures, because you might damage your growth plate further. And then you have incomplete fractures. Now, the reason why you get incomplete fractures in the pediatric population is that because the bone is pliable, and also they have a thick periosteum. So the periosteum is the tissue that wraps around the bone, so peri, so around osteum, the bone. In children, it's very thick. As you get older, it starts to thin out. So when a child falls onto an outstretched hand, like for example, in these AP and lateral pictures, you can see that there's a compressive force going through the bone. The bone's been compressed, but it hasn't broken in this picture. It's just bulged out slightly at this point. So that's what we call a buccal fracture. The bone's not split, the cortex is not breached, but the bone is so pliable that it's just compressed. On the lateral view here, you can see it slightly better, where you've lost only minimal need for any orthopedic input. They can be managed in a cast or in a soft cast, for example, for 2 to 3 weeks, and it should heal quite fine with no intervention at all. Because essentially the bone isn't broken. It's just essentially a really bad sprain of a bone. Then we have green stick fractures. So green stick fractures refers to these two x-rays at the bottom. Again, we have AP and lateral x-ray of the distal radius and the wrist in a skeletally mature individual. Skeletally mature because they have growth plates and not all the bones are fully formed or are visible on an x-ray. So here, a green stick fracture is where, because the bone is so pliable, it can bend. So one side of the bone bends, so compresses, whereas the other side fails, because imagine twisting the bone all the way around, eventually one side will crack. So in this particular fracture, you can see that this side of the bone has cracked, potentially, it could potentially have cracked in compression, and this side of the bone still remains slightly bent, it hasn't broken. In an adult, you'd expect that both sides would break because the bones are not so pliable. They don't move around and they don't have that elastic deformity that the pediatric child's bone does have. And in the lateral view, you can see here that the bone here on the volar or the palmar surface of the forearm is fractured, but the radius on the dorsal the dorsal surface of the radius remains intact. So this is what we call a green stick fracture. So essentially the incomplete fractures can be called either a buckle if there's no fracture, or a green stick if there's a fracture on one side but not the other side. Then we have complete fractures. So here we can, just like another bone, we can have complete fractures of, in children. This is will be a high energy injury. You'd have to manage it according to the ATLS protocol and make sure that you document your neovascular status, as Rory clearly stated earlier, and you check before and after every single intervention that you haven't made things worse. And then you can have complete fractures with dislocation. So here we have the galeaxes and montegio fractures. So, and the top two pictures show you montegio fractures. So montegio fractures are where you have a complete fracture in your proximal ulna, but also with that is a dislocation of the radial head proximally from the proximal radial ulna joint. And as we've mentioned before, looking at the elbow from a lateral aspect can give you a good idea of what's going on. You can see that the radial capitellar line, so the line that goes through the capitellum of the distal humerus and goes down the shaft of the radius, is disrupted. And therefore, the radial head is dislocated from the elbow joint or the proximal radial ulnar joint. The flip side to that is a fracture in the distal third of your radius. So here, the galeaxes fracture with an accompanying dislocation of the distal radial ulnar joint. So the joint between the radius and the ulna there is widened on the PA view. But then on the lateral view, you can see that the ulnar bone, which is here, is not in line anymore with the radius because of the forces that have gone through the bone and then out through the joint. It's akin to injuries in the ankle, but that's for another day. So essentially you can have fractures at the physis, both proximally and distally of any long bone. You can have incomplete and complete fractures of long bones, but incomplete in children because they have pliable bones, and then you have fracture dislocations as well. You tend to see montegio fractures more in the pediatric population. Galeaxes fractures can happen in both adults and kids. So this x-ray here is not a pediatric x-ray, because as you can see, there's no growth plates in this x-ray, which indicate this is an adult or someone who is who has reached skeletal maturity. Whereas in this x-ray with the montegio injury, we can see that we have growth plates at the radial head, we have there in the olecranon, and we have other growth plates in the distal humerus. Going to the lower limb, looking at the thigh, here we have a kind of spiral slash oblique fracture of the left femur of a very young child. You can see that this child is probably not very ambulatory, so this child probably doesn't walk around very often, probably crawling maybe, but it's a high energy injury. So you have to take a good history to ask exactly how this occurred. You have to find out whether or not there's any signs of physical abuse, any signs of twisting, grabbing, scratching around this child's leg, around this child's body. The reason why I say this is because such high energy fractures are very unlikely in kids. So therefore you have to be suspicious that something might have occurred to lead to this. Again, it might not be that the parents are physically always abusing the child, it could just be neglect. not looking after your child, not keeping an eye on your child, and meaning that they get injured quite easily. For example, falling down the stairs or on a regular basis, for example. Transverse fractures indicate more of a kind of assault or trauma than twisting fractures, because they tend to mean there was a kind of a blow or a bang to the leg. And such injuries can manage in a cast like this. It's a spiker cast in the pediatric population. And that's because children fractures tend to heal very well, particularly when they happen in the middle of long bones. They have what we call good remodeling potential, which I'll go into later on in this talk. So now, other fractures, which again can occur in the adult population, but I just kind of highlighted them in the pediatric population because they're quite important. Remember, you can get sartorialis fractures in the tibia as well, and also in the femur, but there's no need for me to show you x-rays of every type of fracture. Just keep that in mind. Here we have a fracture of the proximal tibia. So this is just a simple proximal tibial fracture. It can be managed in an above elbow cast, and it would heal quite nicely in about 8 weeks, and the child can be out of the cast and start mobilizing without any problem. But in the long term, such fractures, particularly in the proximal tibia, and also since it's a weight-bearing bone, can deform as the child grows and as the bone remodels. And here, which is about 12 months to 18 months down the line, the child starts to develop what we call a valgus deformity of the tibia. So valgus meaning going, the distal point goes more laterally. So that's why it's important for children who we see to have proximal tibial fractures. We tend to always want to repeat a follow-up x-ray at around 1 year just to make sure that they don't suffer from this deformity. Now, generally, because children and pediatric children or children are amazing, they tend to recover from this by themselves. So in about 2 years after you see this, the bone becomes straight again. But in some children, as they get older into the teens and the adolescents and the growth plate starts to close, you start to think, okay, you might need to do something to help the bone. You might need to break and reshape the bone to heal in a straighter way. But that's a complex specialist pediatric surgery and limb reconstructive surgery, which you don't need to know about. And looking at the distal tibia, you can have something called a toddler's fracture. Essentially, this is a spiral or oblique fracture of the distal tibia without much displacement. As you can see here, it doesn't displace much at all. And you ask yourself, why is this? The bone's fully fractured, but it stayed in place. And that's generally because the periosteum in the child is, like I said, very strong and very thick, like in an adult. And therefore, it splints the fracture quite well, and the fracture just stays in a good position. And you can manage this in an above elbow cast, above knee cast, and it should heal quite nicely in about 4 to 6 weeks without much problem. Again, I've talked about the proximal and the distal tibia, but there's also a middle tibial shaft, which can also suffer from fractures that are incomplete or complete. So you can have green stick fractures as well in the tibia in some situations. Very rare, but they do occur. So now I'm going to just touch on ankle fractures. So ankle fractures are essentially very distal tibial fractures or distal tibia physis or physio fractures, are special or different in children because at the stage where a child's growth plate starts to close, different parts of the growth plate start to harden whilst other parts are soft. So where you have hard and soft coming together, you have in the middle a transition zone, so a stress riser, a point where things can break easily. You have a soft part and a harder part. So things happen in growing bones that don't happen in the adult population. So in an adult, you might get a simple lateral malleolus or a medial malleolus fracture without much problem. But in a child, because of the forces around the soft and the hard bone, you have different patterns of fractures, which you have to keep an eye out for, because sometimes they're not so obvious on an x-ray. So here, this picture shows that generally, the physis in a child will close starting centrally, then it goes medially, then it goes laterally. So here you can see it starts off centrally, then it goes medially, then it goes laterally. So you see here, centrally, then it goes medially, then it comes out laterally until the whole physis is closed. Usually, girls stop going stop growing earlier than boys. So generally, the close are around 18 years old. whereas the boys can go up to about 21, 22 years old, and then they can go and stop there. These fractures occur. These fractures occur usually in children at around 10 to 17 years old. So this is when the physis is starting to close, to then close and finish closing at the age of 18. So here we have the first type of fracture, which you should keep an eye out for in A&E, is a triplane fracture. So initially we talked about Sotoharis fractures. This is a type 4 fracture, but it looks like this on an X-ray. So remember we said that type 4 is a fracture that goes through. So the metaphysis, physis, and the epiphysis. And it generally looks quite obvious as one straight line. Now, this is a complex type 4 because it actually has fractures in three planes. That's why it's called triplane. It has the fractures in the X, Y, and Z plane. So essentially, this picture gives a good idea of what's happening. So the first fracture, because it's a physis fracture, is in the growth plane. So you can see that this X-axis has a fracture in it. You have a second axis here with another fracture in it, and a third axis around the, out the back, this peak, with another fracture in it. And this is because of the fact that the growth plate is closing at different times, and therefore the softer part of the bone breaks off the harder part of the bone. Yeah. So this area of the bone which is softer there breaks off, because remember I said it starts off centrally, then medially. So here is nice and hard, and this is softer. So it just breaks off, unfortunately, for the child. But sometimes it might look not so suspicious on the child's ankle X-ray, but it's a big, important injury that you have to let the orthopedic team know about, because it's a big injury to the growth plate and can then limit further growth in the future. So here, you can see that they have, on the AP view of the ankle X-ray here in a skeletally mature individual, you can see that this looks like it's a simple Sotoharis three fracture. So it looks like it's simply coming, simply coming down into the joint. So you think to yourself, that looks like a Sotoharis three fracture on the ankle AP or ankle mortis view. When you see that, always think to look at the lateral to see if you can see a Sotoharis two type injury. So if you look here, you can see on the lateral, there's Sotoharis two type injury, which is a fracture that goes above the growth plate, which is there. So this line here corresponds with this line here, which is the plane here in the y-axis. This line here corresponds with this fracture here, which is a plane in the third axis there. Now it's difficult, like we said already, to see a fracture going through. So Sotoharis four, which is through, goes across here. It's always difficult to see it. So therefore what you do is, generally, if you see a different fracture in the AP and the lateral, you order a CT scan. But you don't have to order a CT scan, just let the orthopedic team know that you think it's a triplane injury, and then they'll have a look at it and then they'll confirm yes or no. And then they might order a CT scan to get an idea of exactly what's going on and get an idea of exactly how much of the joints is affected, which can then guide orthopedic management. I hope that makes sense. It could be complex, but it's basically just showing you that the pediatric fractures are different because of the fact that children have pliable bones and growth plates and all sorts of things. Here we have what we call a tilo fracture. So now this is almost like the opposite or the other side of a triplane fracture, in the sense that this is simply the fact that the third part, so the last part to close, breaks off and causes a fracture of the anterior lateral aspect of the distal tibia, and it's intra-articular. It's just a simple Sotoharis three, so it's low. It comes out low, it comes out below the growth plate. Again, so remember you have triplane and tilo fractures. These tend to happen a bit later than triplane fractures because of, again, the older the growth plate is closing in. You can get CTs for this as well to see how much of the ankle joint is affected and how to manage it. And that's usually done by the orthopedic team. So yeah, like I said, Rory's got gone in a bit of detail exactly through history and examination and your initial assessment of a patient, ABCDE, ATLS if it's a high energy injury, and then focus down on the injury if it's isolated. So don't forget to always think about safeguarding child abuse. Like I said, don't always think everyone's abusing the child, but just have in the back of your mind, particularly if the red flags keep popping up. So if the story doesn't make sense, if the child is too young to have such a high energy injury, just think about why that might be the case. When examining children, you have to think about interesting and fun ways to do it, because the child is not necessarily always going to be compliant with the examination instructions. So making a fist to test your AIN, giving a thumbs up to test the radial nerve, which gives you extension, opening your fingers, which is your ulnar nerve, which helps you abduct all your fingers, are things you can do with children as play. You can also turn to give the OK sign, which is a more specific test for your AIM. The fist helps with the median nerve as well. And once you've got your history taken, you've got your examination done, you can then think about investigations like x-rays. Remember to get two views, and remember to always examine the joint above and below as well, just in case there's any referred pain. And then you put them in a cast and let the orthopedic team know about them. So you generally put the wrists in below elbow cast, and usually if it's a fracture that we can accept, we leave it in for 2 to 4 weeks. You put above elbow casts in, you put forearm fractures in above elbow cast, which helps to stop flexion and extension of the elbow, but also supination and pronation of the forearm. With femur fractures, we tend to manage them differently based on how old the child is. So if it's a really, really young child, less than 6 months old, you can have them in a harness, like a Pelvic harness, similar to what we mentioned before for DDH. You can manage children in traction, and this is a good way. So this is gallows traction. So where a child has a femur fracture, and you simply just let their bum dangle off the bed, and the traction will just give them pain relief and allow the bone to gradually heal. It's also a good way to keep a child in hospital for 2 or 3 weeks whilst you try and sort out any safeguarding issues at home without being too, intrusive. So the gallows traction is a good way to help, keep a child in one place so you can monitor them and help them get better. As a child gets older, these things don't work. So you need castings, like a spiker cast, like we showed you earlier on, where you cover the whole leg, the hip, the leg, and the thigh, and the leg with a cast. Like I said, always think about safeguarding and get help from the pediatricians if you think you need it. And refer to orthopedics. I'm always happy to help, to give advice on what's going to happen or what happens next. Again, I couldn't go through all the management for all the fractures because they're so varied and so wide, and depends on the child's age. It depends on what the fracture looks like, and depends on the circumstances around the fracture. But generally, children heal very well. Children remodel very well. So we generally can be a bit more forgiving with non-optimal reduction in children's fractures, because after a year or two, particularly in the younger children, they tend to remodel, the bone grows back straight. Yeah, as long as the bone is close together, generally it's fine. But as a child gets older into the teenage years and into the adolescence, then yeah, it becomes less and less possible to accept these abnormalities. When a young child who's a few years old, a few months old, you can let most things be in a cast for 4 to 4 weeks, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, and they would heal. And the child will be very comfortable. And gradually, as time goes on, the child will remodel into straighter bones. So this is at 6 months, but I promise you, at a year, 2 years, that radius will look straight. Here we can see a femur in a child that is essentially what we call gun stock. So it's overlapping, and still gradually it heals, and then it straightens out as the child gets older. Here we see a proximal humeral fracture. It's shortened, but left alone to heal and remodel back like nothing happened 2 years down the line. So this is something to keep an eye to remember, that children also have a great remodeling potential, which adults don't have. Oh, sorry. So to add to Rory's learning points, I mentioned, don't forget about child abuse. Don't forget about neglect, what physical abuse, for example. And also remember your Salter Harris classification. So it's all in the name, S-A-L-T-E-R. So S for straight through, A for above, L for lower, T for through all three segments of metaphysis, physis, and epiphysis, and E-R for erosion, so to crush it, essentially. So yeah, that's my talk. I hope you were able to get some sort of overview of pediatric fractures and refer whenever you see any of them in A&E.